In almost every musical ever written, there's a place that's usually about the third song of the evening. Sometimes it's the second, sometimes it's the fourth, but it's quite early. And the leading lady sits down on something and sings about what she wants in life. And the audience falls in love with her and then roots for her to get it for the rest of the night.
Leading lady to the stage now.
So in 2018, I heard this song called Omar Sharif. Probably through the magic of algorithms and YouTube, where they probably know how many times I've seen Dr. Zhivago or Funny Girl. Katrina Lenk is out there singing her heart out about her love for Omar Sharif and Umm Kulthum. And I was hooked. I needed to know what this whole musical was about. Well, it turns out that the musical was about Egyptians and Israelis. A relationship which, up until then, for me, looked like this.
Further chill to cold peace between Egypt and Israel. Tensions run high after Egyptian protesters stormed the Israeli embassy building in Cairo. With three dead, dozens arrested, and about 1,000 injured, what does the future hold for peace between Israel and its biggest Arab neighbor?
But not if you went to Broadway. On Broadway, Israel looks like this. No bombs, not even political talk or real fighting, and certainly no more bickering than you would see in your average Hollywood rom-com. It's just people. People who are lost and found through a conflict that only affects a part of their incredibly rich lives. Some may be surprised that the intricately crafted musical is based on a movie. A sad orchestra leader reluctant to find love again. A heartbroken cafe owner wishing for a way out. A lovesick wannabe jazz singer. A somewhat magical phone booth communicating every feeling from love to loss. This could describe any Hallmark movie.
Yes, we actually just compared this movie to a Hallmark Christmas movie, but what can I say? 'Tis the season and all that. Anyway, the real plot is a little bit different.
The movie is about an Egyptian band, the Alexandria Ceremonial Police Orchestra, that goes to a fictional town in Israel called Beit Hatfa to do a concert at the Beit Hatfa's cultural department. The problem? They were supposed to go to a place called Petah Tikva, but the two towns are pronounced identically when said in Arabic. So they end up in Beit Hatfa, which has no cultural department.
No Arab cultural center.
No. Not culture, not Israeli culture, not Arab, not culture at all.
Jahannam.
And the play tells the story of what happens when these band members are stranded in this small town full of what we might call hicks. The show kind of subverts the audience's expectations. People think they're going to see a show that's going to be about a clash of two groups of people that historically don't get along too well. And instead, they see a show about people helping each other out and being decent to one another.
So how does this foreign movie, aimed at the festival circuit and the Cannes crowd, end up a Tony Award-winning musical frequented by tourists and New Yorkers alike? Well, mostly through some changes.
If we're going to talk about differences in production, we're going to have to talk about the context. Because yes, sometimes we have to change things in order to please the audience. And well, because a 2007 Israeli movie is never going to look like a 2017 Broadway musical. The film version of the band's visit, originally titled Bikur Hatz Moret, debuted at the Cannes Film Festival in 2007. It came out with pretty good reviews as it debuted in the US. It was the first feature film by the Israeli writer and director Iran Koleran. Although it was his first movie, the brand new director already had a very clear vision and influences.
I got some influence, I think, from Jacques Tati, and I also thought of Jarmusch movies and Karismaki movies. But I also been influenced by Egyptian melodrama. It's about things that are real to me, but it's not about reality that is outside the frame. So this is why this style of framing was essential for also for getting this story told. You can always feel in this movie that all it's about losing this big story, losing your dream, losing the feeling that you could have lived this other life, but you're not living them. And in the background, in the past, there's the Egyptian melodrama, and up front there is this different, more controlled cinema.
And where some saw a charming movie, others saw an opportunity.
project was instigated by our lead producer, Oren Wolf, who saw the movie 7 years ago and just sort of had this epiphany, this should be on stage. No one agreed with him, including the filmmaker. No one thought it was a good idea. And he saw it in his head. He couldn't articulate it perfectly, so he did what a producer does, which is to start finding people who could articulate it.
There's something very stage-worthy about, there's something almost Chekhovian about the film and the way that these people transform in like a deep and seismic way without realizing it or with us not quite seeing when it happened. There's music in it, and music is one of the things over which the characters bond. There probably isn't any other way to do it than as a musical, or it would be a missed opportunity not to.
You know, just because something was meant to be does not mean that it won't take hard work. In between the off-Broadway opening and the Broadway debut, the show had to go through many little tweaks. According to the actor John Cariani,
the changes have mostly been about improving the clarity of storytelling. We've worked on figuring out when these strangers are cold to each other and when they warm up to each other.
Musicals move at a very different pace. Hamilton, the previous year, Tony Awards winner, told the story of half a century in just under 3 hours. So director David has pushed us to remember to let events unfold at the speed of life, and not at the speed of a musical, but at the speed of this musical. But the bet worked. Sure, some changes had to be made, creating songs that could play for a night at the theater, but the musical garnered great reviews, heading to Broadway and winning all of the Tonys, including Best Musical. It pretty much became mainstream. I mean, from a development standpoint, the movie had much more of an awkward struggle, being a first-time movie and all, than the musical could kind of like sell itself, at least at first, as a descendant of the enormous success the movie had. But even then, there are things that just can't be translated on a stage.
When you look at close-ups of Dina or Tufik in the movie, emotion rushes straight through the screen. There's no need for dialogue, which the movie doesn't really use that much, since everything is communicated through Ronit El-Kabet's facial expressions. It's really the oldest film technique in the book. As a matter of fact, director Aaron Colleran thinks in terms of framing almost exclusively.
But that image of the van pulling away occupied me for a long time as well, because a lot of people were telling me that the screenplay wasn't believable. They asked me, why doesn't someone pick them up at the airport? How to take away questions like that really bothered me. I know there's a big world outside my frame, but inside my frame, I wanted to be in our own world and forget those questions.
So how does a theater crew replicate this? When there are actually so many things going on in the background.
You know, a song in a musical can serve a lot of different purposes, and if you're adapting from a movie, sometimes the song is like a close-up in a movie. You might close up on someone's face and get the picture speaks 1,000 words. Mm-hmm. Music does the same thing.
Friday evening, oh my chérie.
A song can also just be a way of going much deeper into a character or a relationship. You know, that's the other thing that we were exploring in this.
Plus, I mean, there's different ways to frame in theater. So this is different from this. It changes the entire atmosphere. And if you weren't focusing on me up until now, which first of all, rude, well, now you probably are. Or at least hopefully you are.
Everything works the same in the musical, where every spotlight brings your attention somewhere. Most of the songs in the opening act function as a kind of zoom into a character, whether it be Dina's longing or Vroom's love story. They all favor feelings over any kind of plot advancing action. You can check the background for sure, but why would you want to? And the writers are right about the fact that when Katrina Lenk sings Omar Sharif, you don't really want to look somewhere else. In fact, theater has the added advantage of allowing you to do a quick checkup on Tufik with a glance without really cutting from Dina's emotions. You can't do that in a movie. But for all the emotional empathy created on stage with lighting, blocking, and singing, movies still have a very nifty advantage. If the movie wants you to know they're in the middle of the Negev Desert, it can show you the desert. and you'll probably believe everyone is there without much explanation about the scene. You automatically understand the setting. The costumes are automatically hilarious.
Don't you want to take your hat off?
Excuse me?
It's very hot with hats. You can take it off.
Yes, Tewfik, you should take your hat off. It is hot in the desert.
Yes. It's better. No?
In fact, the movie uses this to its advantage quite a bit. It really pans for comedic effects over and over and over. The musical doesn't really have that luxury, so once again they have to rely on their strength, songs. These songs are usually in musicals to set the scene. They're the what, when, and where of the story. Plus, the songs also translate the comedy that was achieved through camera moves, even if it has to be a little bit more direct. So that's not new. That's just telling us what to imagine. The musical goes further than that, though, and actually immerses us in the scene, not with images, but with music.
Going to Israel, everything was new. I was like, oh my God, that's this from the show, that's this from the show.
There's a vibe to that part of the world when it's peaceful that is really beautiful.
The truth of that experience is something that we share together, and that's going to be something that we're going to be telling on stage.
They also performed with some local musicians, like they alternated and then they jammed together.
The fullest expression of each individual is through music. That's what jamming with these guys was. I learned a lot about them and I only knew them for an hour.
The trip fleshed out a theoretical understanding and it turned it into a spiritual understanding.
It's such a gift to be able to refer not to something that you imagined, but to something that you actually felt and looked at with your own eyes. So it's a memory instead of something you've created.
So every night, the audience gets transported to the other side of the world through music. No CGI fur required. No CGI cats required either. No shade to the movie Cats. We don't disrespect it. But some productions have to take into account the needs and demands of the audience. Here's the thing, though. 2016 was not 2007.
Divisions were maybe not at the forefront of everybody's mind. So while the movie had the luxury of exploring tensions in a charming way, maybe forgetting politics for a bit, the musical had to tread a much finer line where the public would likely be more aware of the situation, but also more willing to forget the political divisions for a night at the theater.
No messages for me. You know, if you could summarize your whole film into a message, then why bother spending so many years of your life on doing the film? You do a film because it does not go into certain message. It encompasses and resonant on a lot of thoughts that you have and a lot of questions that you have, and anyone can take some message that he wants from it, but I don't have a message, you know, it's not into one line.
Even if Iran Colin had said multiple times that the movie is not intended to have a direct message or be overtly political, this doesn't mean that the audience will not make the link with Middle Eastern disputes. For his movie, the tensions worked as a kind of a sneaky backdrop. But what about the audience on Broadway? How much of a conflict can you present in 2 hours of music? See, the movie never explicitly states why these conversations are inherently fraught with some degree of tension. But it is there. The characters speak different languages. I mean, the divide is shown but never explained. Why do the opening lines about Arab culture brace us for a conflict but also make us laugh? See, the whole genius in the movie really is to subvert these interactions to make them more comedic. The musical obviously has a few more explainer songs, like Welcome to Nowhere, explaining the culture of the two groups and their motivations. But it can't go for an over-depiction of a conflict, because that's simply not the point.
I wouldn't say that it's accurate to say that the show is not political. I think it's enormously political, but the argument it's making is about the sort of man-made arbitrariness of politics. and that in the absence of those imaginary structures, people connect over all kinds of things.
The musical still shows the divide in a very clever way, through music, again. So the overture tells us where we are, somewhere that sounds Middle Eastern. We talked about this, but then it gets more interesting. Each group has their own sound, so welcome to nowhere.
Let me tell you about Petah Tikva.
Sounds nothing like Soraya, which is purely the Egyptian band playing.
For Welcome to Nowhere, I was trying to answer the question, what is the voice of Israeli sarcasm? Soraya happens as some members of the band settle in for the night. They take out their instruments and start a little jam, almost a reminder of home. I was trying to be as authentic as possible.
So the separation is illustrated in the music, but that's not all, because the second part of the movie is about showing people who can get closer through contact. So music brings people together. Yes, this sounds like a sweet message, a banal idea present in like 90% of musicals. But this is the only overt depiction of the message. Just like the movie can be read as a sweet story about people's longing, the musical offers this in Answer Me. The song near the end that hammers the point for the audience member who simply wants a nice uplifting message to justify their evening at the theater. But both productions can be read on a much deeper level. Just listen to this.
انت الوحدة انت الفرة يتقرهم
So what have I learned since I listened to that song for the first time? Well, probably that I'm a target demographic. No, not because of my undying love for Omar Sharif, but because I kind of was that second audience. I mean, I care about the world's issues, I guess. I knew a little bit about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, at least from a distance. And I'm a sucker for pieces of art that make me feel more cultured about world cinema.
But even hearing those songs now, after going through mountains of research and an unsettling amount of news footage about war, they still reminded me that there are ultimately people on the other side of the TV screen. People who have hopes and dreams and whatever.
And yes, I know this is an extremely cliche point of view. But ultimately, neither the movie nor the musical are going to give you a deep geopolitical understanding about the stakes of the conflict. But they will show you a new perspective. Because ultimately, that's what art is about. Telling you the stories that, in the grand scheme of things, aren't that important. Or are they?